Okay, I'm back with chapter 5, and hopefully I'll try and do 5 and 6 together. I know I said 4 and 5 before, but let's try and combine these. They're short. Chapter 5 is called Sunday Morning. The next morning, Mario came back to the newsstand with his father. Usually, he slept late on a Sunday, but today he was up before either his parents and kept urging Papa Bellini to hurry. They lifted off the cover, and Mario dashed inside. He held up the matchbox and looked in. There was Chester lying on the Kleenex. The cricket wasn't asleep, though. He had been waiting for Mario. He chirped once. Papa smiled when he heard the chirp. "He must like it here," he said. He didn't run away that night. "I knew he wouldn't," said Mario. For breakfast, Mario had brought a crust of bread, a lump of sugar, and a cold Brussels sprouts. He wasn't quite sure what crickets liked, so he decided to try him out on everything. Chester jumped over Mario's little finger into the palm of his hand where the food was. Back in the meadow, his usual diet was leaves and grass, and every now and then a piece of tender bark. But here in New York, he was eating bread and candy and liverwurst, and finding them very tasty at that. When Chester had as much as he wanted, Mario wrapped what was left in a piece of wax paper and put it inside the cash register. Then he slipped the cricket back inside the matchbox and took him over to one of the lunch counters. "Look," he said to the counterman, "this is my new pet. He's a cricket." The counterman's name was Mickey. He had red curly hair. "That's a fine cricket," he said, peering in at Chester. "May he have a glass of water, please?" asked Mario. Mickey said, "Sure," and gave him the glass. Mario held Chester by the hind legs and lowered him carefully until his head was just above the water. Chester dunked his head in and had a big drink. Then he pulled it out, took a breath, and went in for another. "Why don't you let him stand on the rim?" said Mickey. He was very interested in watching Chester, since he had never seen a cricket drinking from a glass before. Mario set his pet on the edge of a glass and gently drew his hand away. Chester bent down to try to reach the water, but the glass was too slippery. He toppled in. Mario hauled him out and dried him off with a paper napkin, but Chester didn't mind the dunking. He had fallen in the brook a couple of times back in Connecticut, and he knew it would take him a while to get used to the city life, like drinking out of a glass. It's funny he calls him his pet because it's a cricket, of course. There they are on the lunch counter having their soda. "How would the cricket like a soda?" asked Mickey. "Very much, I think," said Mario. "What flavor?" Mickey asked. Mario thought a minute. "Strawberry, I guess," he answered. That happened to be his own favorite flavor. Mickey took a tablespoon and put a drop of strawberry syrup in it. Then he added a drop of cream, a squirt of soda water, and a dip of ice cream about as big as your fingernail. "This is how you make a cricket strawberry soda." He also made one for Mario, a little larger than Chester's, but not too big, because it was free. When the sodas were gone, Mickey took a paper cup and wrote cricket on it. "This is his own cup," he said to Mario. "You can come over and get fresh water any time." "Thanks, Mickey," said Mario. He put Chester back in the matchbox. "I've got to go to get him a house now." "Bring him back soon," Mickey called after them. "I'll make him a Sunday, too." At the newsstand, Papa Bellini was talking to Mr. Smedley. Mr. Smedley was the best customer the Bellinis had. He was a music teacher who came to buy Musical America at 10:30 in the morning on the last Sunday of every month on his way home from church. No matter what the weather was like, he always carried a long, neatly rolled umbrella. As usual, Papa and Mr. Smedley had been talking about opera. More than anything else, the Bellini family liked Italian opera. Every Saturday during the winter, when the opera was broadcast, they would sit clustered around the radio in the newsstand, straining to hear the music above the din of the subway station. "Good morning, Mr. Smedley," said Mario. "Guess what I have?" Mr. Smedley couldn't guess. "A cricket," said Mario, and held Chester up for the music teacher to see. "How delightful," said Mr. Smedley. "What an enchanting little creature." "Do you want to hold him?" asked Mario. Mr. Smedley shrank back. "Oh, I don't think so," he said. "I was stung by a bee when I was 8 years old, and since then I've been a little timid about insects." "He won't sting you," said Mario. He tipped the matchbox up and Chester fell out into Mr. Smedley's hand. It made the music teacher shiver to feel him. "I heard him chirping last night," said Mario. "Do you think he'd chirp for me?" asked Mr. Smedley. "Maybe," said Mario. He put Chester on the counter and said, "Chirp, please." Then, so Chester couldn't misunderstand, he made a chirping noise himself. It didn't sound much like a cricket, but Chester got the idea. He uncrossed his wings and made a real chirp. Papa and Mr. Smedley exclaimed with delight. "That was a perfect middle C," said Mr. Smedley. He raised his hand like an orchestra conductor, and when he lowered it, Chester chirped on the downbeat. "Do you want to give him music lessons, Mr. Smedley?" asked Mario. "What could I teach him?" said Mr. Smedley. "He's already been taught by the greatest teacher of all, Mario, Nature herself. She gave him his wings to rub together and that instinct to make such lovely sounds. I could add nothing to the genius of this little black Orpheus." "Who is Orpheus, Mr. Smedley?" asked Mario. "Orpheus was the greatest musician who ever lived," said the music teacher. "Long, long ago, he played on a harp, and he played it so beautifully that not only human beings, but animals, and even the rocks and trees and waterfalls stopped their work to listen to him. The lion left off chasing the deer, the rivers paused in their courses, and the wind held its breath. The whole world was silent." Mario didn't know what to say. He liked that picture of everyone keeping quiet just to listen. "That must have been awfully good playing," he finally said. Mr. Smedley smiled. "It was," he said. "Perhaps someday your cricket will play just as well. I prophesy great things for a creature of such ability, Mario." So a prophecy is like making a prediction for the future. So Mr. Smedley knows a lot about music, so he's saying that the cricket, he sounds so fluent and so nice, and his tone was so nice just from his natural ability. "You hear?" said Papa Bellini. "He could be famous, maybe." Mario heard all right, and he remembered what Mr. Smedley had said later on that summer. But right now, he had other things on his mind. "Papa, can I go down to Chinatown to get my cricket a house?" he asked. "A house? What kind of a house?" said his father. Jimmy Lebowski said that the Chinese like crickets very much, and they build special cages just for them," Mario explained. "It's Sunday," said Papa. "There won't be any stores open." "Well, there may be one or two open," said Mario. "It's Chinatown, and besides, I could see where to go later on." "All right, Mario," Papa Bellini began, but Mario wasn't waiting for any buts. He scooped Chester into the matchbox, shouted goodbye, Mr. Smedley, over his shoulder, and headed for the stairway leading to the downtown subway trains. Papa and Mr. Smedley wanted to watch him go. Then Papa turned to the music teacher with a happy, hopeless expression on his face, shrugged his shoulders, and the two of them began talking about opera again. So I think I will make another video then for Chapter 6. So stay tuned. Chapter 6, he goes to Chinatown, and that's a little area in New York City. So maybe in your research, you can look that up a little bit. And then he meets someone called Cy Fung. So that's Chapter 6. Bye.